You know, when Brother Branham would come over there, he'd come visit us. I would give him my tithes, always. And the kids see us giving tithes, then have their tithes in their little envelope. Might just be a few pennies or what have you, you know. But they'd give them to him too. And he said, you know, I hate to take this, you know. Well, that's all right. One day he said, Brother Collins, can't you think of someplace else you'd like to put your tithes? I said, Brother Branham, if Jesus Christ were here, I'd give them to him. I said, you're the closest thing to him I know of. Amen. He never mentioned that no more. That was all right. We were with him down in Tifton, Georgia. A wonderful meeting. Had a prayer line. And after the service, we went to the motel, and we were sitting in the entrance into the motel where they had a couch and chairs and what had you. And Brother Ryan was sitting there talking, and Brother Welch Evans says, Brother Branham, what was it you told my sister in the prayer line tonight? Brother Brown said, I don't know. I don't know. You know, and sit there and talk a little bit. Directly, he went right back into that prayer line.
Absolutely.
1, 2, 3, 4, that's her. And told him exactly what was told. And he was really inspired under the anointing in such a marvelous manner. And I'm going to tell you what he said. He said, the people of Martin Luther's day will have to walk before him in judgment. The people of John Wesley's day will have to walk before John Wesley in the judgment. And the people of this age will have to walk before me, he said,
right.
In the judgment.
Right.
We've had more before us than we realize. It's real.
Every
bit of it is.
Man.
Yes, sir. I don't know. I'm going to tell it anyway because I don't understand it. Don't expect you to. But Brother Banks Woods had a heart attack.
Yes, sir.
And when he did, there was a dream or vision or something that there was a cat after Brother Banks. That's what the heart attack. And in the dream, Brother Banks said, Brother Branham said, Banks, you want me to help you? He said, I think I can handle it. But Banks got real sick. And while we were in Tucson, Brother Branham took us to first to eat after he had killed a lion. And that big lion he said, I'm tickled to death. I said, well, what is it, Brother Brown? He said, I got that cat today that was after Banks. Here we are. And he was. And he lived to be old. Now, you understand that? I don't. But you know what? I believe it. For the simple reason, because he said, one time, Betty came down with a rupture. She had a high fever, and a rupture came out about the size of a hen. We took her to Dr. Hicks out here on Dixie Highway. Said, yeah, I said, she'll have to have surgery and repair that. We came to church, and Brother Brown had just a fast prayer line. Betty went through the prayer line. After that, we met him out back. He said, what's the matter, Betty? He said, well, she's got a rupture. Okay. Well, it wasn't too long. She got up one morning. It's all gone.
Amen.
All of her sins. Oh, it's just marvelous. Marvelous. One time, we always tried to go to the meetings. We had a little old travel trailer. It wasn't much. 16-foot long. But it was a way that we could go and be in the meetings. We try to go, and you know, Brother Branham would visit us sometime during the meeting in that little old travel trailer. Well, we went up in Chicago, the Marigold Arena, one Sunday evening. That was after Brother Branham had told us how to conduct ourselves in the auditorium. Well, the Marigold Arena is nothing but an entertainment place. They had all kinds of pictures on the wall and what have you. But when we got there early. People was talking, laughing, all that. You know how it is. And when we went in, we respected it as though it was the tabernacle. We read our Bible, prayed, you know. And then when Brother Brown came to the prayer line, he didn't want anyone that he knew, because someone said he already knew, you know. But he called this one, that one, another one out. And directly looked back there and he said, that light is hanging over Sister Collins. He called her out, told her some things, really encouraged her heart. Beautiful. Then later he come to see us. He said, do you know why the Lord called your wife out? I said, no, I don't have no idea. He said, because y'all respected the place like the tabernacle when you came in. Respected the place. And the Lord made known it. It's just beyond anything I can even hope or think. One time, Brother Brown came over. He said, Brother Collins, he said, I don't know what to do. He said, I lost my credit card. And I don't know what to do. He said, because I have to travel. I can't carry enough money with me to take care of everything. And he said, I just don't know what to do. He said, I can't get one. And my wife did my book for me. And I said, Brother Branham, have you ever filled out a Gulf credit card? I'm on the Gulf station. He said, no, it won't do any good. He said, they'll go back, said it wasn't my fault. But he said, I signed the check, but they failed to send the money in, and said they canceled me. And said, it'll go right back to that, I can't get it. I said, well, why don't you fill out a Gulf card? Well, he said, okay. He sat down at the desk where she worked at. He filled out an application for a Gulf card. After he left, I turned his application over, said, I will be responsible for any bill he encounters, and I signed it. I wasn't afraid to do that. And about 2 weeks later, the Gulf man came in and said, you going to get your credit card? Well, I knew then, I hadn't even applied for one. I knew Brother Brown was going to get his credit card. He came over, just thrilled to death. He said, I've got my card. And I don't know if these machines will pick this up or not, but here is where he bought gas. Now, I think you'd kind of like to buy gas like this. It was 15 gallons plus. It was $4.85. And there's the card. Now, I wouldn't send it in, because if I'd sent that in, Brother Branham had to pay for it. But by me keeping it, I've got it for a souvenir, and he didn't have to pay for it. But you see, he signed it and everything, and all I had done was turn it in to Gulf, and they'd collect it from him. But I kept it, and I cherish it. Because, and like I said, I believe that's the very reason that the Lord has helped your wife and me all these years. Now, come time that we went to Arizona, Brother Brandon took us along Mount Lemmon, and on our way up there, you that have been to Mount Lemmon, how many have been to Mount Lemmon? Let's see your hands. On our way up there, these big boulders that's standing there, looks like you can just push them over. Nothing around, just standing. He says, do you know how come those rocks like that? I said, no. He said, in the days of Noah, while the flood was receding, going down, it was sloshing against those rocks. And it washed everything out from around them, and they stood that way ever since. Okay. Then he was going to move to Tucson. And he knew I wanted to go. And he come to me. He said, Brother Collins, I know you want to go to Tucson. I said, yes, sir. He said, wait till I tell you. I said, okay. Well, later he called. It was some little time later. He said, Brother Collins, I told you, I'd tell you when it was time. I said, I believe it's time. He said, because there's been a group following me out here. They've got nowhere to go to church. And I promised them I wouldn't start a church. But you didn't. He said, I believe it's time. I said, okay. Well, we went out to look things over. I didn't know what I was going to do with the station. I tried to sell it 3 times. It didn't sell. It didn't go. Brother Branham came over and he said, you tried 3 times. He said, don't you think that's enough? I said, yeah, he said. He said, when the time comes, you won't have any trouble. So we went out to Tucson to look things over about moving. We came back. I had an old gentleman just watching the station while we was gone. I didn't ever think he would be interested in it. When I pulled up coming back from Tucson, he said, I heard you was wanting to sell the station. I said, yes, sir. He said, all right, let's inventory it. I want it. That's how simple it was.
That's right, man.
Mm-hmm. Okay. One night, Brother Brian was preaching, and he took a group into this room over here to see if the third pull would start here. He said every other pull started here. Wanted to see if this one would too. My wife and mother was with the group that went in that room that night. He stayed a little bit. He came back out. He said, no, wasn't the third pull. Visions and everything as usual. But that wasn't it. But you know what? I believe one day we're going to see that third pull come completely in view.
Yes, sir. Amen.
Now, this is my perception of something. And I hope it's right. And I believe it is. Used to, when we used to go to the picture shows, they would show a preview of the one for next Saturday. Just a sketch of it. So you come back next Saturday. I believe we have only seen a preview of the third pull.
Amen.
But I believe it'll break into view one of these days.
Yes.
Something I wanted to share with you. Brother Branham, well, my wife's one had the dream that her and Sister Meade and Brother Branham and me were all fishing. I caught a fish that was white and didn't know what to do with it. Didn't know how to handle it. And my wife went and got Brother Branham. He come and just took that fish, took it out of his mouth, put it on a stringer, said, that's the way you do it. Marvelous, you know. Well, she told Brother Brown the dream. And he said, well, let's see what the Lord will say. Okay? One day, he sent word one Sunday evening for us to come up the house. Said, I've got the interpretation of that. Well, we went. But you know what? there was a minister there, and he wouldn't leave. Brother Branham would not mention the dream, nothing. He never did tell us what that dream was. But here's the only thing that he ever said about that dream that I knew of. I still don't know what it is, but he was preaching here in the service. His own why Christ speak. He said, Brother Collins, now he was really preaching under the anointing. He said, Brother Collins, don't worry about that fish. It was white. You just didn't know how to handle it. Lay aside everything else contrary to it. Remember, this is the truth regardless of how fanatical it seems, and everything else, move right on. It's the Holy Spirit, the same God that raised up Jesus Christ from the dead.
Amen.
Now that's what I know about the white fish. This part, I dread to get into. He came over one day. He said, Brother Collins, I'm going to have to leave you. I said, oh, no. He said, yeah, got to go. Got to leave you. And it shocked me. I thought, it can't be. It just can't be. And we took him down to a stone restroom to eat. I said, Brother Branham, something bothered me. He said, well, what is it? I said, does God change his tactics? Because I said, he trained David all of his life for the climax of his ministry. That was to slew Goliath. I said, he was in training when he slew the lion, when he killed the bear. He was in training all this time. He was the only one that knew how to do it and could do it. And I said, Brother Branham, you're the only man that knows the tactics of the enemy. Only one that knows how to defeat him in every case. And I said, God didn't pull David off the scene and somebody else step in to finish up the job. I said, does God change his tactics? He smiled. Now, he already told us it's going to leave us. He smiled and said, God does not change his tactics.
Amen. 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 Amen.
After this, Naomi had a dream of Michael being in the morgue. Brother Brown came over. She told him the dream. She was just weeping her heart out. Because Michael had, he'd been healed, but she dreamed he was in the morgue. And her and me was hunting for him, trying to find him. And it was of the night. And said, while we was trying to find him, somebody slipped up behind us and put his hand on her shoulder, and it was Michael. And she was just worried to death. Brother Branham walked out of that restroom in the station, and there was a big tree standing there. He said, I looked up in that tree, and I saw your dream. He said, that's not a bad dream. That was a good dream. That was Michael's healing. I thought, my. Sometimes we get ahead of the hounds and don't know what's going on. You know, I was getting ready to resign here at the church one time. We was trying to get people to adhere to church order, be quiet and everything, you know. And it was hard. People, you know, was used to something else. And they fell out with us, especially me. I got up to speak and they'd go out the door. I put my hand out to shake hands with them, and they turned their back. I thought, I'm the ones keeping them away.
Well, I went to Brother Branham. No, I didn't. I wrote out my resignation. I was going to resign on Sunday. And I was thinking, I'll let them come back to church. I'll just get out of the way. Brother Branham called me on Saturday before I was going to turn my resignation on Sunday. I had it written out. He said, Brother Collins, I was up in the mountain praying. He said, the angel of the Lord told me to call you. He said, what's the matter? I said, well, I guess everything's all right, Brother Brown. He said, no. There's something wrong. I said, what's the matter? I said, well, I was fixing to resign because people fell out with me. I said, I don't blame them. But they fell out with me because of church order. And I thought they're leaving church. And I thought maybe they'd come back if I'd resign. He said, don't you do that. He said, the reason they went out from us is because they weren't of us. Mm-hmm. Very shocking.
All right. I sold the station, moved to Tucson. Got there. I'm going to skip over some stuff. But I got there. Brother Brown came down with the station wagon. He says, my wagon's missing a little bit. Said, I wish you'd look at it. I said, all right. I checked. There wasn't much wrong with it. Somebody put a condenser in that had a longer wire on than it's supposed to have and caught. And every time it would advance, it ground out. I fixed that. And I said, Brother Brown, I've heard that there's going to be some things in the church age book that don't sound just right. See, I didn't know whether Brother Vale was just inserting those things. I didn't know. Brother Vale was writing the book, you know. And he said, what was it? I said, well, I heard that people will be going to heaven without being born again. Oh, he said, that don't sound right, does it? And I said, no. I didn't think so, but I didn't understand. He said, I'm going home and check on it. Okay? He went home. He checked on it. Called me back. He said, Brother Collins, he said, the church age book is right. Not just that one phase of it. He said, the church age book is right. He said, there will be people go to heaven because they were kind to the bride, the brethren. They will be granted eternal life at the white throne judgment. They don't know what they're doing when they do it. They don't do it for that reason, but it's because it's something in them. I thought, that's outstanding.
Amen.
He come to see us, sit down in the trailer floor, and he drew this. If you notice, he started out here with a circle black, had another one partly black, another one white. On this side, black, black, black. Now he said, this represents the woman at the well. This represents the Pharisee. Now he said, the Pharisee was a good man. He said, he would have made a good pastor in any church. Oh, they'd have been tickled death at him for a deacon. But said, he heard about Jesus. It didn't change him. He just went right on. And at the end of the road, he was still black as soot. The Pharisee. But he said the woman at the well was an ill-famed woman. She was black as soot. But she heard about Jesus and she began to turn white. At the end of the road, there wasn't even a black spot on. Now he said, here's what it was. She had a representation up here. The Pharisee did not have any reciprocation. Strong meat, but it's the truth. All right. Brother came to our home. I'm going to wind up as quick as I can, but some things I'd just like to share here. Brother came to our home, said, I've got to see Brother Brown. Got to see Brother Brown. Okay? He got an appointment with him. And he got to see him. He come back. He's very disappointed. I'm not calling brother's name, but he was very disappointed. I said, what's the problem? He said, well, I got that little church. And Brother Brown's going to have a tent, and I wanted to be in that tent. And all I was going to ask him to do was pray for the Lord to send the pastor of that little church so I can be in the tent. And he said, when I told him, he didn't even offer to pray. I said, really? He said, no. I said, what did he say? He said, you just make sure you're in that tent. Oh, my. On Thursday night before the wreck, Brother Brennan took us up to the house where he was going to move into. And he was very, very inspired. He always was, as far as that matter. But he was just really in depths of the Spirit. He was talking about Sabina Canyon, how it come down there and how it wound up and this, that, and the other, you know. And he was talking about the sign on the door. He said, that sign on the door says, as John the Baptist was the forerunner of the first coming of Christ, you will be the forerunner of the second coming. Now he said, I always said the message, but he said, that's exactly what he said. He said, the reason I've said that, to try to direct it off of me. But he said, that's the truth. That's the very way he said it. And he was started talking on, and I'm going to share this with you now. You don't have to believe it, but it's what he said. He said, I believe it's about time for the tent. Now that knocks in the head all those that's already been, but it's on Thursday night for the wreck on Saturday night. He said, I believe it's about on Tuesday night. He said, I believe it's about time for the tent. He said, I will ride this trail once more.
Amen.
He said, it's thus saith the Lord.
Amen.
Every other time I've rode it from the east to the west. But he said, this time I'll ride it from the west to the east. And you talk about authority,
yes,
it will be God himself.
Amen.
That's what he said. I thought, my. Then I told him some dreams I'd had. And he said, that's interesting. But he said, I could tell you what I think, but let's wait and see what he says. He called on Thursday night before he come back here, before he was headed back this way. And he said, I got the interpretation of those dreams. He came over. He said, you tell those dreams in order as you had them. I said, Brother Brownham, I don't remember. He said, all right, you had this one first, this one second, this one last. But the one that really stood out to me, I'll share it with you. I'm not going to take time for all of it. But it was short. I dreamed I was in bed sleeping. And I knew it was dreaming. But I dreamed that Brother Branham came near. And he had what it looked like a walking stick in his hand. It was like a 3/8 copper tubing. You know about what it would look like. And it was bent in the shape of a walking stick. And he come in with that. And I looked at that. I said, I know one thing, Brother Branham with his staff will deliver us. That was the dream. Well, when he went to interpret it, he said, If you remember, and I told him, I said it was either brass or copper. I couldn't tell which because of the color. He said, if you remember, Moses carried a wooden staff. I said, yes, sir. He said, the one you saw was not copper, it was brass. Divine judgment. Then on that awful night, we got the word. Brother Branham had the wreck. Someone called, I don't remember who it was now, said, Brother Collins, Brother Branham's had a wreck. Said, it looks bad. I said, well, how bad is it? Said, it looks awful bad. Said, I haven't been able to get Brother Branham out yet, but it looks bad. Said, oh my. Well, Brother Roberson called. I told him about it. He said, well, I'm going to tell you one thing, Brother Branham will be all right. Because he told me that he'd meet me on some mountain. I said, yes, sir. He said, but for the life of me, I can't remember the name of that mountain. He said, I just can't remember it. I said, yes, sir. Directly he called me back. He said, Brother Collins, I remember the name of that mountain. I said, what was it? He said, Mount Zion. Well, we got there to Amarillo. We come by Friona. They said he'd been transferred on to Amarillo Hospital. We got there. I went in. Nurse took me back. He's in intensive care. They had him laying on his left side. She went to that side, and I went to the other side. She tried to rouse him, said, Brother Branham, you've got nothing. Didn't respond to anything. She left. And I walked around on the other side. I was desperate. I said, Brother Branham, this is Brother Collins. I said, everything will be all right, won't it? I knew the Lord was able. And I didn't figure he could talk because they had that thing in his throat from debris through. I said, if it will be all right, bat your eyes. He opened his eyes and looked at me. He not only batted his eyes, but he shook his head. Be all right. But I never dreamed it would be like it is. But still, be all right. Of course, he went on to be with the Lord. And when he did, they had him in a funeral home there in Amarillo. In fact, this is one of the funeral home cards where he was at. I don't know if it was shown on the machine or not, but it was Blackburn and Shaw. I went down there. I told him, I said, he was such a marvelous man. They said, would you like to see him? I said, yes. They said, he's just like he died. I said, we haven't done a thing to him. We've just got him in a shipping casket to ship him back to Jeffersonville. But he said, you can see him. They opened the door on the casket. The sight I saw, I know Brother Branham told us there'd be a Catholic boy getting, and it was a Catholic boy. And he said, I think they'll give me either in the head or the throat, and I believe we'll be shot. When I looked at that scene, there he laid, looked like a high-powered rifle bullet had gone through his throat. They shaved his head to open it up so his brain would swell. Nothing but raw stitches. I knew then that Brother Branham had seen his own body before this accident. He described it too well. And I believe that But someone told me that he told Brother Jack Moore that he had seen his mangled body. And of course he told us at the age of 56, which everything went just exactly according to the way Brother Randall told us. Well, it's getting late, and that's all I'm going to try to share with you now. But this is the truth, the best of my knowledge.
Amen.
And Brother Brown has done such a great work among us.
Amen.
And I'm here to tell you, it's not over.
Amen.
There's more yet to come.
Amen.
How? I don't know. When? I don't know. Where? I don't know. But the Lord will fulfill every promise that He's made to us. God bless you. Thank you so much for your kindness and for you being so patient. God bless you. We love you. Let's bow our heads. Heavenly Father, how I appreciate this place. It means so much. Lord, thank you for being here. For the angels lining the walls.
Yeah.
For your great presence. Thank you for the messenger. Thank you for the message. We know it's true, every bit of it. And Father, help us all. We want to be there. Oh, what a day that would be. We can be gathered on the other side. This same group of people to rejoice together over the things that you have done and are doing. Keep your hand upon us, for we ask it in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you. Thank you.
Service and these memories that we've had here. This is amazing. Let's see.
Well, welcome back. My name is Jim Jeffords, and we're in the pastor study of the Branham Tabernacle. It's going to be my privilege for the next few minutes to visit with Brother Collins. A lot of times when you hear someone speak or give their testimony, as Brother Collins has just done, you say, well, that's wonderful. If I just had a few minutes that I could visit with that brother and ask him a question or two, well, hopefully over the next few minutes I'll ask maybe a question that you have on your mind. I will say this. I, I first met Brother Collins 29 years ago. I was a young Baptist preacher coming into the message. I had read some books and tapes. I didn't know much, but I knew that I needed to be baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. I'd never met a message preacher, never been to a message church. I didn't even know where I could find one. But I figured if I showed up at the Branham Tabernacle, they'd help me take care of it. So one Sunday morning, I showed up with, I had my clothes and my towel, and Brother Collins baptized me. Now, I'm sure he didn't remember that because he's done that for hundreds of folks over the years, but it always stands out in my mind. And then about 12 years ago, my family moved to Kentucky. We never got all the way to Jeffersonville, but we got close enough to call this our home church. And for the last 12 years, we've been proud to call Brother Collins pastor. And of all the wonderful ministers I've met in the message, I just can't imagine anyone over the years who would have the temperament or the wisdom, the patience, and I'm sure sometimes courage to do for the Branham Tabernacle what Brother Collins has. So we certainly appreciate it. And I'll just say this, the one thing that I appreciate about Brother Collins the most is when I first moved here, I'm sitting in the congregation, and I'm keen to observe, and I notice Brother Collins did a lot of things different, and I'm just kind of scratching my mind. I'm just saying, well, why did he do it that way? And it was just like somebody whispered into his ear. He'd come back and say, now the reason we do it this way is because that's just how Brother Branham did. If Brother Branham knew a better way, he would have done it some way different. So, Brother Collins, we appreciate this opportunity to visit with you.
Thank you.
We certainly enjoyed your testimony. And since we're in the pastor study, a lot of notable things have taken place here. Would you like to just maybe comment? As the best I know, this is basically the way the room looked when Brother Branham used it as an office.
Brother Jefford, I appreciate this opportunity to visit with you. And the study is almost as it was when Brother Branham was here, with the exception of the big picture. The eagle wasn't in here. this picture up here wasn't in here. Brother Branham's picture was here, but some sister said it belonged to her, and she took it. And a young fellow drew that, and I hung it there. But outside of that, the other pictures, the desk and everything, is just like he left.
You did such a great job sharing with us about how you met Brother Branham and your move up here. But one of the questions I've always wanted to ask you is if you could share with us a little bit what it was like for you to move up here to Jeffersonville. All of us came out of something, but mm-hmm. when you left the Methodist Church, you left your job, mm-hmm. Which was some form of security, which had a parsonage. Mm-hmm. And by all accounts, you had a bright future with the Methodist mm-hmm. Church. And I know you were compelled because of the truth of the message.
Yes.
But at the same time, here you've got a young family, and you mentioned no promise of a job. Mm-hmm. Share with us a little bit more what that was like.
Yes, that was something that, if it hadn't been really deep in your heart to do this, you never went through with it. Because I had four children, wife and four children, to take care of. And not knowing how I was going to do it. Well, just I say this. There have been many times we went through hardships since we left the Methodist Church. But not one time have I ever looked back and said, I wish I hadn't done it. Not one time. Because every hardship, I knew there was going to be some way out. And the Lord has certainly done a real marvelous thing for us all the way.
Now, you mentioned your family, how Brother mm-hmm. Branham prayed for your son, Michael. Mm-hmm. You mentioned your daughter, Sister mm-hmm. Barry, Betty. Mm-hmm. And I know the families were close because you had children close to the same
right.
age as Brother Branham's children. Could you share with us a little bit more, maybe some of the personal glimpses of the families intermingling or the children?
They played together a lot. Brother Branham would bring his children over to play with our children.
And he said, I'm glad to bring him over here because I like for him to play with kids that are disciplined right. And he would bring them over there, and we would let our kids go to play with his children there. And we just really, the Lord just worked everything out so good. We just can't hardly get over it.
Mm-hmm. Give us a little better glimpse of what it was like coming to the tabernacle in the mid to the late 50s. As Brother Branham was out on the field, mm-hmm. As one of the biggest evangelists out on the field. Mm-hmm. I get a little glimpse maybe on Easter when we have so many visitors and they're just so happy to be here and they pull a little bit harder, they expect a little bit more. What was it like just coming to the Branham Tabernacle when Brother Branham was to speak?
It was so much expectation every time he would speak because people was expecting something new every time, and they could hardly wait for the service. Like, for instance, he might be going to speak at 9:30. At maybe 3:30 in the morning, there'd be people lined up out there to get in the church. And there was enough people here when the doors were open, the church was overfilled right away. People were just so on their toes, you know, to understand something. Now, for instance, when he preached the Church Ages, I wanted to get into those things this morning, but time just didn't permit it all. But when he preached the Church Ages, we were expecting, you know. And I stood around the walls. The church was smaller then. And when he had completed the Church Ages, he drew it on a blackboard. Now, each age, how much light it had in it, and he had that on the blackboard. Well, the angel of the Lord came at the end of that and drew that very same thing on the back wall of the church.
And where were you
sitting? I was standing along the wall over on that side. And Brother Branham said, if you want to see something, turn around. And it was there.
How long did that last?
Now, you've asked a hard question there because it's hard to say. It seemed like several minutes. And the way that I saw it, and you might ask someone else and they might have seen it differently, but the way that I saw it was as though this was back there and had so much light in the first one, you know. It would be just like clicking a camera to change the view, like it stayed the same, but it changed the darkness on the picture. And then when he come to the last one, it looked like it just all black.
Mm-hmm. Now, to follow up on that, it seems like there was that same expectation, if not more so, when he preached the seals.
Oh, yes. Because of what happened in the Church Ages, everyone expected something greater in the seals. And I believe there was something waiting for us if we had been able to have seen it. Because Brother Brown would continually tell us, there's something I want you to get, I want you to get, I want you to get. And we didn't get it. And I don't know what it was, but I've often thought, I wondered if that would have been the right time for the rapture if we had just been the right atmosphere for it, you know. But after the seals were over, and Brother Woods told me that he asked Brother Branham, he said, Brother Branham, why did we not get what you was expecting us to get from the seals? And Brother Branham said, you weren't supposed to get it. But I still don't know what it was.
Now, there's two questions that maybe you could share with us that would help some deacons who are watching this, and ministers. So you serve the church as a deacon.
Yes.
And you made reference to Brother Branham gave him the church order message, which we have on tape. What What would you share with a deacon that's listening out there that could help him maybe in his position to understand his position more or to be a better deacon, of things that you learned from being a deacon here?
Well, the best thing that I know in regard to being a deacon is have a feeling for the people to start with, and then deal with them according to the word to assist the pastor. Because the deacon's job is to assist the pastor in whatever he would want a person to do. And first of all, they'd have to have the right kind of a pastor.
And as a minister, what did you learn from observation, being around Brother Branham, that just stands out in your mind or maybe helped you to be a better preacher or minister of the gospel?
Well, he always told me to stay with the word regardless. And another thing he told me too that was very interesting to me, because I always thought that a minister would have to have something new every service. But he said, don't worry if you repeat over what's already been said or done, because that's understandable. If you notice, you'll hear Brother Branham preach a message one place and then go someplace else and preach along the same line. And we always thought that shouldn't be done, you know. But just the fact to see a man of God like Brother Branham, how he humbled himself to place other people above him, and he'd do it every time, to make them feel good, and he would share with them everything the Lord would permit. And that's the best advice I can give any minister, is never feel above the people, but if anything, let them be elevated.
Tell us about your experience of getting the Holy Ghost, because Brother Branham talked about you and some other folks on tape that you were seeking the Holy Ghost. Mm-hmm. Then he comes back a few days later and he mentions you again.
Yes.
As a Methodist minister who has received the Holy
Ghost.
Yes, you did. So we've got some young people or new converts who are seeking the Holy Ghost. Mm-hmm. What advice from the experience that you had with Brother Branham from the message could you share with someone who's seeking the Holy Ghost?
Okay, now, they might not share the same thing that I did, but I wanted the Holy Ghost when I found out it was for me. That was my heart's desire. And I was trying with all I knew how. And we went up to the Chautauqua meeting, and we parked our little camper along the side of the Miami River. And I aimed to get into some of this morning, but I just didn't have time. You know, you understand. But my wife had a dream. And she dreamed that she was out there at the Miami River in their little camper, and she saw two little evergreens there. And each one of them had, it looked like, a little snake in it. But it was harmless, each one of them. And while she was standing there, there was a huge snake that ran over her feet and into the Miami River. Well, we didn't know what had happened, you know. She was concerned about her dream, but I wanted the Holy Ghost. So I'd go down the river a ways and pray a while, and I just... waiting on the Lord is all I could do. And I'd bought me a Timex watch while I was up there. And I was down there praying. When I did, my watch stopped at 12 o'clock while I was praying. Then my brother Clyde was coming up, and he got there, and I was talking with him, and I said, my watch... bought me a new watch, but it's no good. It stopped. And I said, you can shake it and go a little bit and stop again. Shake it and go a little bit and stop again. And I showed him. And he said, yeah. And I said, but it's all right. They'll give me another, I'm sure. And Brother Branham walked out on the platform at 8 o'clock that night to minister. My watch started running perfect. And that really bothered me. And this happened while I was up there praying for the Holy Ghost. Well, after the meeting, I found some excuse to go by Brother Branham's house. And I went by. And he said, you won't know why that watch stopped. I said, yes, sir. He said, I'll tell you what it was. He said, the watch represented you. You was trying to get out of the ministry and everything. And said, somebody would shake you and you'd run a little bit and then you'd stop. Shake you and you'd run a little bit and then you'd stop. But he said, since you received the Holy Ghost, you're running perfect. And that was when we got back from that meeting. And that's the way it transpired. And I didn't speak in tongues. No manifestation like that. But there was just a settled peace. And that's the best I can explain.
You talked about several experiences where people were healed. Mm-hmm. I'm sure you've seen hundreds of prayer lines. Mm-hmm. Is there any other healing or discernment that just kind of stands out in your mind? You say, oh, I could just never forget that.
Yeah, well, there's several of them, really. I mean, there would be no end to that. But one event took place here. Brother Branham was praying for this little guy, and his stomach was real large. I mean, real large. And they were poor people, and they had him in bibbed overalls, but they couldn't bring them together to fasten them. They had a grass string in one side, a gap about yay big, and a big old pin in the other side, and a gap real big. And Brother Branham stood him on the altar rail out there, put his arm around him, and offered a simple prayer for him. And when he did, he just stood there just a little bit with his arm around, talking to the people. While he was talking, he reached around here and took that string out and buttoned that nut. He reached over here and took this pin out, buttoned this nut. Then he got a hold of his trousers, room for another man in there with him. Now that happened standing right there on the platform.
Is that right?
Uh-huh. And another thing was Brother Wade when he died. He was on that front seat. Well, there's a row of chairs out there. And he was in one of those. And he just died, I mean, instantly. And his wife, being a registered nurse, she just run and checked him, you know, real quick. And she saw that he was gone, and she screamed. And Brother Brown just kind of settled the people. Walked back calmly down where he was and asked the Lord Jesus to let his life come back into him. In just a few minutes, he was on his feet. So, there's no end to it, but we could go on and on with this miracles that I've seen the Lord do through Brother Brown's ministry.
I've heard you several times over the years, and something just comes to mind. You say, well, I was talking with Brother Branham about certain Bible questions. Does any of those come to mind today that maybe you'd like to share that you thought was interesting?
Well, of course, they're all interesting, you know. There was several times of scriptures that I had misunderstood. For instance, I've got a daughter that she just was going every way but the right way, you know. And naturally, it made me wonder what I had done that I shouldn't have done or where I'd failed. And it come to me what Brother Branham told me. The scripture that says, train up a child in the way it should go. When he grows old, he won't depart from it. And that's where I was thinking that I'd been a big failure somewhere. But I remembered then that Brother Branham told me, he said, people misunderstand that scripture. He said, the child may depart from the teaching, but the teaching will never depart from the child. And I thought that was so interesting, because I'd taken it the other way. And he said, no, I said, that's exactly what it means.
Mm-hmm. We all know Brother Branham had a sense of humor.
Oh, yes.
Is there anything that you can think of, and when you think about it, it always just kind of brings a chuckle to you?
Oh, yes, yes. Several things. One of them is him wearing my sock, you know. of course, that was when we were squirrel hunting, and he helped me hunt for the sock, but we couldn't find it. And then when we got back, and he'd already changed clothes, and his sock and my sock was there. And I went to the door with it, and I said, Brother Branham, I found my sock, but I said, it's sopping wet. And he said, yeah, I had it on. But that brings a chuckle every time. And there's other things. He come over, and my wife was too serious-minded. And he told her, he said, don't be so serious-minded. And he would say something to bring a laugh, you know, or a chuckle, and maybe sing a few verses, some song or something, but something just to snap her out of it. And he told her, he said, I'll tell you what, sometime you just sit down and just start laughing, and laugh till you laugh at yourself. Oh, there's so many things that I could go into, but I don't think we'd have time.
Tell us a little bit more about your move out west.
Mm-hmm.
Did that give you an opportunity to spend more time with Brother Branham, or because he was traveling, less time? And then the other thing I was thinking about, Brother Branham, he made the statement just a few years earlier. He says, now, he was talking about you, that he says, well, I believe he'll soon be a full-time, you know, minister. Mm-hmm. Again. Mm-hmm. Was that on your mind, or what you said today, your testimony, that, or you were running from that?
I was, definitely. No, my move out west gave me more opportunity to be with Brother Branham and to associate with him. And I know one time the Mosley boys had given him a Jeep, and he was tickled to death with that to hunt in. They put a Chevrolet V8 engine in it, and it was quite a nice looking machine. And he got it all loaded up, ready to go hunting, and I don't know who put the hitch on the car they was pulling it with, but he was riding in the Jeep and just trying it out to see if it would track. And the hitch fell off the car or truck, whatever they had it hitched, hooked onto, and dug in the blacktop road, and it bent the Jeep in the middle, the frame, just bent it. And he called me, and he said, Brother Collins, he said, I don't know whether the Jeep can even be fixed or not, but said it looks like it's ruined, but said, I'm going to transfer into a truck, and if you can do anything for it while I'm gone, see about it for me. And I went and got it fixed while he was gone, and had it for him when he got back. Although he never got to hunt in that Jeep, but he was sure pleased with it. But it gave me a lot more time, and some serious time, when we went up to the house and everything. That was the time that I felt was worth more than the move out there, just to be with him even that long. But I got to be with him a good bit out there.
Well, tell us a little bit more about the atmosphere at the hospital. From the folks that I've talked to, it's just like you mentioned, Brother Roberson says, well, everything's going to be all right. Nobody could even comprehend Brother Branham going off the scene.
No.
Yet you mentioned that a couple of years early. I don't know when was the time frame, but he told you that he was going to be leaving you.
Yes, he did.
Was that on your thought, or just tell us a little bit more about it?
I was afraid that was the time, but I was hoping against hope that it wasn't. Because I knew he was going to leave us. He had told us too emphatically that he had to leave. But I was sure hoping that wasn't the time. But it seemed like the atmosphere there at the hospital, everyone thought he was going to come out. They was worried about Sister Meadie making it, but they didn't seem too concerned that he wouldn't make it. But the Lord saw fit to do it some other way and took him on.
Now, how long was it after Brother Branham passed away that you moved back here to Kentucky?
It was approximately 4 years.
4 years.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Moved back, and by that time, Brother Neville had become disabled to take over the duties of the church and keep it going, and the congregation was falling off, there was very few coming, and the deacons asked me if I would take over the church, and they was going back to what Brother Branham said when they put me in as deacon. And I said, I'll do it under one condition. You go back and get a vote from the boards, both boards, trustee and deacon board, and it'll have to be 100%. Then if it is, then put it before the church, and if the majority of the church wants me, I will come and do my best. And so they did, and they called and told me, said, come on up, said, you're voted in.
And would you mind sharing with us something you told me the other day, which I never knew? But
tell me.
You said that Brother Branham had actually told your wife and your mother,
yes,
that someday you would be, yes, pastor of the tabernacle.
He did. When we went to my mom's squirrel hunt, my mom's and dad's, I mentioned that this morning. When we went there squirrel hunting, he told my wife and mother, someday Brother Collins be pastor of the tabernacle. And I said, you know, that would be the one thing that I couldn't have believed if he had told me. Because that's me, little me, just impossible, you know. But he told them that, and then later they told me. But I said, that would have been awfully hard if he had told me that. I'd have thought he'd just kidding.
Now, I had somebody ask me a question the other day, so I'm just going to ask you.
Okay.
They said, well, is Brother Collins pastor for life, or do they still have elections? Why don't you explain that?
Okay. We have an election every year. And I've been voted on now, I believe, 36 times. I believe that's right.
Now, is that the way Brother Branham did when
he had an election, annual election. But now, I'll tell you, we couldn't do it the way he did it and get by with it. I've seen him come out here and say, well, folks, it's time for another annual election. Said, I want us to take a vote this morning. He said, how many is in, said, we've had a good year. Everything's gone well. How many is in favor of leaving it just like it is? Well, every hand would go up, you know. But, see, we couldn't do that now because they want to vote individually. And that's fine. That's no problem. But there is an election every year on the pastor, the deacons, the trustees, the secretary and treasurer, every year are voted on.
Mm-hmm. Now, I mentioned to you earlier there's some questions I wanted to ask you on a certain vision Brother Branham had. You made reference to it in your testimony. Mm-hmm. is the tent vision.
Yes.
And for those that are not familiar with the tent vision, mm-hmm, this Brother Branham had this vision of a great evangelistic service,
yes,
where he gave an altar call.
Yes.
And then he gives a little more detail. He says it was a change in the order of the service,
right,
where he was to pray for people. Mm-hmm. But he said it could have been in a big auditorium or a cathedral, but he said to me it looked like a tent.
Yeah.
So for that reason, people refer to it as tent vision. I'm sure you're familiar.
Yes, yes.
Several reasons that I wanted to ask you some questions on that.
Okay.
Is, first of all, he talked a lot about it. You mentioned that today.
Yes, he did.
He talked a lot about it. He seemed to be excited about
it. He was.
Brother Branham did say on tape, he says, say what the tape say what the vision say. So yes. I think it's worthy of discussion. But it also, there are a lot of questions about that vision in particular.
Yes.
Certainly there's a lot of opinions.
Yes.
And as you mentioned earlier, there would be no end to questions.
Right.
And a lot of questions would be no answers.
Right.
Opinions, I found, are kind of like elbows. Everybody has one. Most people have two.
But right.
I thought where you could be helpful is at least to confirm, or in some cases to clarify, just exactly what he said regarding that vision. And again, I think I can speak for the people watching this on video, we value your opinion, because not only did you get to hear in person what we hear on tape, but you were there before the service, after the service. You were one of the ones that many times helped him to the car. You had dinner with him, you went hunting with him, you observed him for 10 years.
Mm-hmm.
So your witness is very valuable to you. In fact, when I was putting together some questions, I thought about this. In a court proceeding, a lot of times they have to have an expert witness. And if there was such a thing as an expert witness on the message, you'd be one of maybe a handful of people that would qualify as an expert witness. So, just a couple things. First of all, Brother Branham, as he describes this vision, he calls it a vision. And then he talks a lot about visions. He says visions are direct from God. He said in the Old Testament it was death to disbelieve a vision. He says once a prophet gives a vision, nobody but God can stop it.
Mm-hmm.
If you have anything in reference to this vision, but visions in general, is there anything, we got a lot of quotes, but did Brother Branham say anything to you personally regarding the authority of a vision, or how that you can have a confidence in a vision? Anything that you comes to your mind?
Yes. He said any vision that the Lord gave him will come to pass. He said there's no way to stop it. Someone he prayed for and told him they'd be all right. And because he saw it. And they came back later and said, Brother Branham, it's just hard for me to be able to believe, you know. He said, regardless, the vision said you'd be all right, and you will be. Even the vision would go above even their own thoughts. And you made mention of the tent. He told me, he said, I'm going to call it a tent. It may not be. He said, it may be a huge auditorium, but what I saw looked like a tent. Now, he said, I don't know how many services I'll have in it, but I do know I'll have one because I saw it.
Now, I heard you mention one time he actually pointed out a particular building,
mm-hmm.
and he says it kind of looked like that.
Yes.
Could you maybe describe what that building looked like?
It looked in the shape of one of these new tents that they blow up, rounded.
Mm-hmm.
That's kind of the way it looked, but he said it was huge.
Well, coming back to the confidence of a vision, so if there's a young person that's listening, mm-hmm. to us talk, the vision of judgment on the West Coast,
mm-hmm.
even though it hasn't taken place,
mm-hmm.
or the vision of 1933, where he said there would be a woman that would rule, you know, the United States.
Mm-hmm.
It could,
mm-hmm.
be a president, a woman president, could be the Catholic Church.
Mm-hmm.
But even those that have not come to pass, we can have confidence that they will come to pass.
100%.
Okay.
You can base your life on it.
Now, when Brother Branham, I'd have to go back and look on tape, but I think it was the first time that he was telling about this vision that he had.
Mm-hmm.
He says, you old timers, I guess.
Yes.
Folks that have been around for a while.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, remember when I used to here from the platform or the pulpit, say, I had a vision. You write that down. In fact, if I'm correct, he encouraged people to write it down in the file leaf of their Bible.
Yes, he did.
And oftentimes people would actually, I think of the little boy in Finland, because when the scene took place, he says, look in your Bibles. Is this not, you know, what you had written down? Okay. But he said, now, when he's talking about this vision, he says, this is going to be just like that because it's thus saith the Lord.
Yes, he did.
Now, we have that on tape, but is there anything personal that did you ever hear him say when he's talking about this particular vision that it's thus saith the Lord?
Yes. That's what he made mention of, that when he told us he would ride the trail once more, it's getting about time for the tent. He said, I will have one service in that tent. I don't know how many, but I do know I'll have one because I saw it. There will be a tent or a huge auditorium. But the thing that always comes up is, where will it be? Someone said, if you really believe that, why don't you put up a tent there at the church? I said, you don't understand. We don't know where it'll be. We don't know when it'll be. We don't know how it'll be. We just got the promise, and we know it will be.
Okay. Now, earlier I said Brother Rand referred to it as one of his greatest visions.
Yes.
And maybe I should quote him directly. He said, in January of 56, right after he had the vision, he said, Friday is always minister's day at the parsonage when we can have ministers come. Let me just stop right there. Are you familiar with what he's talking about? Did he have a lot of ministers over on Fridays, or did they like to come by and visit? I'm sure they did.
I'm sure they did, but that part I don't know.
Okay. But he says, we were so crowded yesterday, knowing that the great vision that just happened, and we're fixing to plunge into the greatest thing I've ever known of in my life. Is that consistent with his attitude when he refers to the tent or talks to the tent?
Yes, it is.
Okay. Now, he always refers to the vision. He says many times, he said, well, you've read my vision or that vision or the vision, but he always said it in the context of a tent. Mm-hmm. So you talk to him personally, you're sitting in their congregation as well as other people. He talked about, of course, he'd be at different places, and he said this would be a good place to have a tent. Mm-hmm. I'd like to sit in here for several weeks, those type of things. And he was looking for it any time.
Yes, he was.
But he said in one place, well, if we just had a ballpark or a farm, then all we need is our outbuildings. Mm-hmm. So there was no question that Brother Branham was looking for a literal meeting of some kind. In an auditorium, a building, or a tent.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
He was, definitely.
Now, Brother Branham seemed really excited about it. In one statement, he says, I'm like a child with Christmas anticipations.
Right.
So he started talking about it because he had the vision in December or the late 1955. Mm-hmm. Starts talking about it in January. So all these years go by. Mm-hmm. And but it never takes place as he sees it, and yet he's still looking for it.
Yes.
In any of your conversations, did he ever seem to be discouraged because it hadn't taken place?
Not at all. Not at all. He was still anticipating that it would be here all of the times I talked to him about it.
Now, I had heard him talk about where he went into the back room, and I never knew until you mentioned it in your testimony that he actually took your wife and
mother.
Your wife and your mother was back there in that room there. With whoever, was there others?
There was others. Yes, there was.
Okay.
There was others.
And so did Brother Branham seem discouraged? I know he was excited because he knew it would be a gift when it was an operation that would be of benefit to the people. Mm-hmm. And that's one of the reasons he was so excited about
yes.
it. But he never got discouraged.
Not at all. Not at all. No.
Okay.
Not at all.
Now, I've got a couple more questions here.
Okay.
Did he ever speak to you in private regarding this vision? Now, you mentioned, like in 1960, even 1965, he's still talking about it. Other than what you mentioned in your testimony today, or you may want to even elaborate more, what did he say to you in person about this vision or the tent meeting?
Well, he just told me that it will be. That's all. Because a vision does come to pass. And he was anxiously waiting for it to come. In fact, at one point, he was ready to go into a tent to see this vision fulfilled. That was, some minister died that had a big tent. And the minister's wife offered it to Brother Branham. And he was anxiously waiting to go into it. It had trucks and everything. But the Lord evidently showed him not yet. Kind of like his going to Israel. You remember when he was ready to go to Israel? And he was in the hangar ready to move right on into Israel. And the angel of the Lord said, not yet. It's not time. But he didn't say you won't go. He said, it's just not time. And that's the same way of this. It just wasn't time. And he didn't accept the offer because it wasn't time for the tent.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Now, today you mentioned the third pole. In that vision, there was a little room. Brother Branham gave the dimensions of
yes,
12
did.
By 20,
yes.
And he says people came through and they
yes.
were, he mentioned a woman on a stretcher, I think someone on crutches,
right.
They came through and they were healed.
Right.
So as he says, I kind of brought up above the crowd and was kind of watching what was going on, and the angel said, as he pointed that little room, he says, I'll meet you in there, and that will be your third pull.
Yes.
So whatever the third pull encompasses, that's part of it.
Yes.
As he meets, is that to your understanding?
That's exactly. Now, I'll tell you how he said that, and I don't know, this may be on tape, and it may not be, but he said, I was standing above the people, and the light went in that room. Now, he said, I was doing everything I could to get my feet on the ground, and the angel said, I'll meet you in there. Now, what that means, I'm not sure, but I know it means something. He said, I was doing all I could to get my feet on the ground. There's some reason for that.
Now, Brother Branham mentioned to you, and I think in various ways, even though he wasn't specific, he told others, well, you know, I've got to leave you.
Mm-hmm.
He even said on tape, he says, I must lay quiet
yes.
for a little while. And in that same message, which is in Look Away to Jesus, mm-hmm. he said also in that message, he speaks of a press to come.
Mm-hmm.
But he says, whatever that press is, but when that press comes, he says, then watch, you know, the third pull then.
Right.
So here he has mentioned that he's going off the scene.
Yes.
Maybe he doesn't know all the specifics or the timing, mm-hmm. but he's still looking for that tent.
Yes, he was.
So when was when was the last time, let me just ask you one more time, that he spoke to you about that vision or the tent?
On Tuesday night before we had the wreck on Saturday night.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Well, Brother Collins, I appreciate you taking this time. And as you say, there would be no end to questions, but I appreciate you taking the time. And I personally appreciate you, and I know the folks watching this video appreciate you.
Brother Jeffrey, I can't thank you enough. We appreciate you too, brother. You've been a real asset to the church, and the Lord's richest blessings rest upon you. We appreciate everything you're doing. God bless you.
God bless you.
Thank you.
God bless you watching this video.